Hey, it's Peet and Reet, and welcome to our show. Today, kind of a special show for us.
For me, it's entirely special.
And you know, actually, is anybody you ask, do you know this person?
And they do.
Yeah, so I think he's been in their heads, and anybody that's ever watched, he's been in their heads.
Forever.
Of course, he's not a psychic, right? He's not a fortune teller.
No, he actually calls himself just an entertainer, but he's much more than that.
Absolutely much more than that. Why don't we tell him who's here?
The Amazing Kreskin.
Welcome.
Welcome.
How's it going? I have to tell, and I know this is a new series for you folks, but you've been together for, you said as long as 10 years in radio, huh? Actually, folks, I'm not supposed to say this publicly, but they've been working together about 70-some years, but they look good and they kept each other. I'm only kidding. But I got to tell all of you looking in, because you've followed me obviously through the years as a mentalist and my work dealing with the mind, I got to talk. I've spoken to Reet earlier, but to this gentleman, Peet on the right, I'm on the air, we're live with him, and I got to tell you folks looking in, God forbid I read his thoughts on the air.
See, I knew.
Mind.
I knew.
But you know, you're good people. We talked to your producer and what have you. And I want to quote me. I say this about all of them, on the two of them here and the production people. They're good folks. They're flaky, but they're good. And those are the only.
I like being flaky, though.
But those are the only interesting people.
You know what? You're flaky too, though.
That's exactly. Do you know my pictures? I'm sitting actually in my office, but my pictures of the people that are close to me through the years. Can you see my hands the way I hold them? They're on the wall, but they're on the wall like this.
A little crooked, a little cockeyed.
You know, in an era right now where we're going through something in the United States called being politically correct, I have a sign in my office here that if anyone ever calls me that I'm politically correct, they're to kick me in the ass.
I agree with you. I 100%. Hate that.
And remember, there's no age limit when you're in broadcasting either, right?
Yeah, that's true. You know, I've been in the airline industry. Well, I've been in this for a livelihood. I did a series on the CTV network years ago called The Amazing World of Kreskin.
From 1970 to 1980.
YouTube has about 30 copies of the shows. For 2 years, it was the highest rated show for 2 years. Second only to hockey, but nothing beats hockey, obviously. Even the good Lord would have to take a detour if he walked through town and what have you, where there's a hockey game. But this is, Canada is like my second home. So much has happened to me through the years. I tour about 10 weeks a year in Canada. And the airline industry now estimates that I have flown in my career just a little over 3 million miles.
Wow. Well, you started out in Ottawa with that show, right?
What happened, the owner of the company sent a gentleman to follow me in the States in concerts. And I appear at universities, I appear at banquet halls, I appear in theaters. I didn't know that he was in the audience around the country maybe for 3, 4, 5 months, show after show after show. He went back to the owner and said, you know, I think there's a series here, because what I do for a living is basically involves my audience. There's no footlights between myself and the audience, because I'm reading the thoughts of my audience. It's not an illusion. It's not an act where there's theatrical stunts. I'm tuning in on what people are thinking. And that's why I think people keep coming back through the years. So an interesting thing happened that you folks in Canada don't know about, and not many people know about. The second year of my series, and it was on weekly, it was a half-hour show. A couple of things I did at the end of the half hour failed. They just didn't work out. That's the way we went off the air, because it was never a rehearsal. Never a rehearsal. So in the second year or so, I was asked to meet with the head of the network. And that was in Ottawa at that time. The show moved to Toronto a year later, but I went to meet him. I walk in his office. And it wasn't that there were predators in the office. It wasn't that there were ominousness. It was worse than that. There were six attorneys. And I am not knocking please, I'm not knocking attorneys. I just wish that most of them had been on the Titanic. So anyway, so I walk in and we're talking. He says, Kreskin, he said, you don't rehearse the show. We trust what you do and so forth. Last week you did this special test and it didn't quite work. Would you consider doing a segment of your show over again if something fails? And now, for the first time, many of you have ever heard this, I didn't get temperamental. Oh my God, this was early in my career, but I said, sir, I'd just like to leave and give some thought. I walked out of the office, walked down the hallway at Ottawa, at the network CTV, walked downstairs, called my manager in Pennsylvania and said, I don't know what to do. I don't repeat what I do. It's got to be done with integrity. And he said, just let them think about it. Well, the owner made a decision because the reason my shows are not edited is a failure is part of what I do and it's the integrity and honesty of it. And he gave a ruling. My show was never, ever in the history of this series to be touched or tampered with. What he does, let it be the way it is. So there was one show I did, and the gentleman was a member of the Chubb Safe Company. On the air, against the wishes of the head of his company, he came on and said, Mr. Kreskin, I give you my word. I'm the only person who knows the combination of this safe. I told him what I was going to attempt to do. He says, I've watched you week after week. This is like the third year. I trust you. Hear this. On the air, we talked. Nothing was prearranged. He's the only one who knew the combination. And he agreed to climb in the safe, for which I slammed the door. And he was the only person who knew the combination. Now, lest anybody thinks this is insane and I was irresponsible because I can't always succeed. I had a man there with machine gear drill, and it was decided if I fail at a certain point, he's going to drill holes to put air into the safe. So I try. Whenever I hit the safe, he was to start thinking of the numbers. Every time I turn, it never worked. The door did not. I finally said, I don't know what to do. You're going to have to drill because I can't get the combination. We heard motions inside. We heard machinery. And here, because he was a safe man, a technician, was able to disimpart the inside of the safe and play around with the combination, and he got the door open. And he said, oh, my God, we were about to drill. Let me tell you what happened. When the show went off the air, I said to the man with the drill, you know, I was about to ask you, you had to drill the holes. And he said, Kreskin, please sit down. I said, what do you mean? He said, had you asked me at that point, it was too late. The drill would have taken too long and he would have never had the air to live.
Wow. I'm going to hold you right there. We're going to come back on the Peet and Reet Show.
Tell you a follow-up on that. Follow-up on that.
Yeah. Follow-up, yes, with more of the Amazing Kreskin and lots more stories.
And welcome back. You know, here we are listening to the Amazing Kreskin.
Incredible. Who is,
and he's the first story he's telling us is
it's
a story
about a guy in a safe.
Yeah, who can't get out, and he's supposed to get him out and almost die. So continue the story.
Well, to wrap it up, Chris, I wish the man had let me know ahead of time that the air had been running out. I would have stopped. But, you know, I'm going to tell you something. That gentleman agreed to come back 1 month later, had a tremendous argument with the head of the company and said, no, I want to go on with this man. He said he would have a man with a drill there. I trust him this time around. And he came back on the air, another safe, and a new combination, and he went in it, and within about 2.5 minutes, I turned the numbers that kept coming to me, and I successfully opened the safe. But you know, my the best way I can describe what I do is, my work is like an adventure. A man who reviewed me at a theater in Pennsylvania some years ago, and I was working there for a week, opening night, he didn't review the show. And you can understand, folks, what happened? Next day, there's no review. Finally, the following morning, he came two nights in a row when he came to the matinee, and he said, watching Kreskin each night on stage is like my reviewing a mystery story, but the solution is different every night. Because I can't say what the audience is going to think about. One man in Las Vegas, I mentioned two names at the Riviera. This elderly man real quick stood up, and I said, who are these people? He said, Kreskin, we're not from here. We're from somewhere else in the country. These are our pets. We love them. I said, didn't you say to your wife, I wonder if Kreskin can tell me my army number? I wish we had a camera for television. He slammed his fist on the table and said, damn it. He said, I said that to her at dinner at another place, not even here. We were eating somewhere else. I said, who knows your army number? You folks ask your friends or uncles or what have you, or sisters. Nobody forgets it, but they don't tell anybody that. He says, I don't think I ever talked about my army number. I said, concentrate. I gave him every single digit in his army number, and he was in World War II. But the only way I was able to do that is he had to know it in his head and to think about it.
Amazing.
That's where the first name, you know, I didn't intend. You know where I got that name? There was a man on television for many years. His name was Johnny Carson.
Ah.
You were on there 61 times.
61 times in 10 years.
The truth of the matter is that he never forgave NBC. He was very bitter about it. He would never talk about it on the air. They, in the early days of television, didn't pay attention to recording shows. They erased the first 2 years of his shows. They're not in existence, completely erased, and it was a terrible thing to do. Actually, I did 88 shows with Carson, 88 shows.
88?
Wow.
I used to go on the plane, and people, when I'm going on a plane, and people would say, hi, Amazing, and I think, gee, that's nice they said that. Hello, Amazing.
And didn't you actually change your name to that?
Carson had a routine with Ed McMahon, and now I know where I got Amazing from. He'd say, Ed, Kreskin was on last month. He was only 90% amazing. And Ed McMahon said, no, Johnny, it was 92% amazing. And I made a routine. And that's how I got the word amazing before my name. On this program, it's amazing that I fully comprehend a certain gentleman you're sitting next to.
Thank you.
I got to ask you a question. Now, your show was shot in Canada, Ottawa at first, then in Toronto. And I have to tell you something, because not to put down Canadians, but back then, Canadian television, you could tell when it was a Canadian television show.
Yeah, an American broadcast, very different.
And your show, totally different, set design, everything. I mean, it was dead on.
Can I tell you this also? Can I tell you this, how successful the show was? During that period, I did appearances in Japan, and I went to England every week for 2 years, because the last 2 years of the show, we did it out of England, because the show was seen all over the world. What had started in Ottawa and went nationwide became international, and you can see about 30 of those shows. So can I mention a book that I've written that I'm real? It's not that I'm interested in selling it, but people might want to buy it. No, I'm
absolutely.
You certainly can.
It's called In Real Time. I got to tell you the story about. Look at the cover.
Ah,
Is that a crazy cover? Well, it's my 20th book. It took me years to write, because in this book are my predictions. What's going to be happening in the world in the next 5, 10, 20, 30, 500 years, 1,000 years. I'm not a fortune teller, but because I've done thousands of programs, 5.5 years touring Saudi Arabia, the stories I can tell you of things I picked up. People ask me, and by the way, you can get this. There's supposed to be a sheet on the table here, you know, that tells me where the book can be ordered.
Not there.
Oh, wait a minute. Your businessman didn't do his job then.
No, it's not on the table. It isn't even here. Can you believe it?
Well, that's all right. Get it when we go to break. It won't be a problem.
We're going to hold you there anyway, and we're going to come back.
Can we wait till we get back?
Yes.
Absolutely.
And I want to find out more about the book, and I want to find out what was your prediction 20 years from now. What was your prediction coming up in 20 years?
Well, let me tell you. A prediction that dealt with one of your prime ministers when we get back.
Right. On the Peet Reet Show.
Well, they don't call him amazing for nothing, the Amazing Kreskin. I mean, first of all, okay, let's think about how long we saw the show back in the 70s and 80s, okay?
I can't remember not seeing it, really.
And other than dyeing his hair blonde, okay, you look exactly the same. How are you doing that?
You know something? I celebrated a year ago, not this year, but last year, my 80th birthday, and a year ago, a little over a year ago, if you counted all the radio and television and concert appearances in 1 year, it was exactly 364 around the world. 364. Well, I wrote this book, by the way. I want to tell people where they can get it. For a mentalist, I didn't know where you could buy the book. You can go on the webpage and look at Barnes and Nobles and so forth. You can go to my webpage and order it from me, where you might get a special card inside it. But it's I'm going to send a book to you folks in the mail. But it's Barnes and Noble, and I'm very, very excited about it. But I have to tell you a prediction that took place not too many years ago in Canada, when the CTV came to me in 2008 and said, we have a gentleman running again for office, Martin, Prime Minister.
Yes, Jean Martin.
Jean Martin, yeah.
They said, would you consider...
Are we talking John Chrétien or Paul Martin?
Martin. The one who he ran again for, he'd been in office and re-ran again.
Jean Chrétien.
I say Martin because I have French background. No, I don't have any French. My family's from Sicily and from Poland, and I love Polish jokes.
And you speak French, so it's okay.
So anyway, I said, you know, I never announce political predictions ahead of time. They say, no, we know how you feel, Kreskin. And I say this to you people in show business, going into show business. My politics is important to me, but you start getting involved in politics, you start dividing your audience. And the audience hearing a prediction would blame me if the person did win or didn't win. So we sealed it, you're not going to believe this, in a safe, a small safe. And it was put on the 6 o'clock news for 30 nights on the evening news on the CTV network, every single night.
I remember that. I do remember that.
Too.
Yeah, and it was there, and he'd point. But let me tell you the background story. And I delivered it a day or two before, because, you know, I want to say this, and I wish that the politicians here in this country, and by the way, I've been knocking them, but one thing I can say about your politicians and my politicians, I've been quoted, the politicians here in the States and your politicians in Canada, we have the finest politicians that money can buy. So let's not in any way, and I think I've said something rather significant there in saying that. But in your country, what do they run for? They campaign about a month and a half. I think that's the time frame, something like that. It's true in England. And by the way, in this country, it's not 30, 35 days. It's 30, 35 years. It goes on and on. You realize this political thing is going on. And now I got to say something to all of you watching me. Please, let me correct this. No, the people you see me with, yes, I performed in Trump's home. That's why you see the pictures of me. I've been with Clinton. Christie was our governor, so he had me a lot of events. Now I won't make an appearance with him. This is as a performer. I'm not endorsing anyone now, but they asked me to predict if Martin would win or not. We sealed it. What I did not know this is when I came on the morning show, which is like the Today Show, you have a national show. He brought the safe on. I stood away from it. A man flew in from the White House, from the president here in the United States. He happened to be in the city the day that I delivered it. He says, I want to see the results of this test. They opened the thing, and as I predicted that Martin would win and what have you. And suddenly, and I don't remember saying things this stupid very often in my life, I said, you know, if this government ever collapses, it's going to be, it was 22 something weeks, or I forget, well, months, I guess it was something, but I said, it's going to be 22 months and he will never be reelected again. We went to black. And this is what you folks watching didn't say. I went over to the producer. I said, my God, I said, this is asinine. I succeeded in predicting how many people would carry him through in his part, what have you, and all that jazz. And my to say this many times it's going to collapse. He said, you crazy, Kreskin. We're getting calls from all over the country. You've lit up the phone. I said, what stupidity I made. I forgot about it. Months later, I came to my house here. The light on the phone was blinking. 84 calls from Canada. If you remember history, his government collapsed to lack of faith, and I was off by 5 days. And to this day, I don't know what made me make that prediction. Story, you can look up on the records.
Well, you know what? We've talked about a lot of instances. I mean, there's just, he can tell you story after story after story. Yeah, but I'll tell you what I want to do. I want to go back and find out how somebody even starts to think about this and do what you do.
Exactly, but we're going to do that in a minute when we come back with Kreskin and Peet and Reet on the Peet and Reet Show.
That I foresee. We're coming back. I foresee that.
And you're watching the amazing Peet and Reet.
I hope we're amazing.
I've got to be honest with you. I don't feel so amazing after listening to, no, to Kreskin,
I mean,
for
this,
the last couple of
seconds. He has had such an illustrious career that went on for decades and still does. He still performs, yeah, which blows my mind.
And we got to ask you this, okay? I mean, the things you do still amaze people. If you go back and watch your shows on YouTube, they're still amazing. They still stand up to today's standards. But how does a guy like you start something like this? Does it start when you're a little kid? Were you born with it? Was it Mandrake the magician that did it for you?
Very interesting remark that you said Mandrake, because if you look at the cartoon of Mandrake, which was when I was a kid, and it's not true, I was not born in the 1880s. It was about 1890. But it was a tremendously popular cartoon written by Lee Falk, who also did another cartoon called The Phantom. And in the Second World War, one of the most popular cartoons in one of our enemies at that time, and I'm Italian, so don't even misunderstand me, but Mussolini was with the Axis powers, with Japan and Germany and so forth, was Mandrake. And he wanted the public read Mandrake every Sunday with the color and so forth, but he didn't want to use the author, Lee Falk. So another man wrote Mandrake during the Second World War in Italy. His name was Fellini, the great director. And Fellini's, one of his greatest ambitions, was one of the failures of his life. He wanted to do a movie based on Mandrake. But Mandrake was not a magician. He had hypnotic powers. He read thoughts. And he thought, this is going to look like a cheesy trick photography movie. And he never, ever finished doing, he never did the movie. But years later, I was at a conference where cartoon professors and students were honoring Lee Falk. I said hello to Lee Falk. This was about 10 years before he passed on. He's talking about Mandrake, and I got to share this with you. One of the most wonderful memories of my life was at Sardi's restaurant in New York. He says, I want to stop now for a moment. You're asking me about the Phantom and Mandrake, but I think I need to let you know this. Since I've written Mandrake in 1935, through all the years, the only human being who's come closest to being exactly my character is the amazing Kreskin. Wasn't that a one? Something like that you cannot buy. So let me tell you what happened. You asked me. When I was 5 years old, I was visiting some family in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, and a young man gave me a comic book. It had in it this cartoon character, Mandry. So I come home with it, and my mother sat with me and would read the Sunday or the cartoon things, and I would read them with her. I started reading when I was 7 or 8 years old, and today I read 4 books a night when I'm not traveling. My library built here that the BBC in England has film art.
Hey, let me stop you there for just 1 second. Did you say
four books a night?
Yeah, yes I do. Yeah.
I'd be on 4 pages.
It takes me to read a novel about 14 minutes, 14 to 16 minutes. Technical book about, and I won't go in, that's not, I don't brag about, some, but my library, I'm going to expand it. My home for my books is now 9,000 books because I read so constantly. So I was imitating as a kid Mandrake, and then the final key story that Carson found so fascinating, in third grade, it was raining outside. And our teacher said, Miss Curtis said, well, you're not going to go out and play. where I'm going to teach you a game. Jane, she said, Jane Hamilton was her name, go out in the hallway. She was in our class. I was 9 years old. And we hid a beanbag in the class. We put it in one of the desks the son was sitting at. So as she calls, Miss Curtis calls Jane and says, Jane, a game we're going to play. You walk around. If you're getting near it, the class will see you're warm. If you're not near it, you're cold. If you're real close, you're hot. Hot and cold is a children's game. So when she got real hot, she was near it. She rummaged around and finally found it. I was very disappointed I wasn't picked to play this. I walk home, a mile home. I walked a mile to school from kindergarten to 12th grade. My brother was home. He's 3 years younger. My mother was shopping. My father was at work. I said, let's go over to Grandma's house. They live 7 minutes away. My grandfather built the house himself. I said, Joe, go upstairs, hide this penny. My grandparents rented the room downstairs because that's the way they paid their rent. They were from Italy. He goes upstairs, hides the penny. He finally calls me. I run up the stairs. I'm only 9 years old. And my grandmother's sitting behind a table wondering what's going on. And I walk through the kitchen. I walk to my uncle's bedroom. I climb up on a chair because I was short. And I reach behind a curtain rod. And there's the penny. And then it dawned on me. I forgot to tell him to talk to me. I didn't tell him to say anything. He just stood in the kitchen. My grandmother, being Italian, must have thought I had the evil eye. Well, the bottom line is this, folks, and most of you know this. In all my performances around the world, I turn my check over to the audience and I'm escorted from the theater guarded. My check is hidden anywhere in the entire theater auditorium. When I come back in, they call me when they've hidden it. The committee's on stage. They never talk to me. They never say anything. If I fail to find my fee, through their I don't ask questions. I have to physically find it. The money goes back to the people who booked me, and the show is for free. Have I ever failed? I failed 10 times now. Once was in New Zealand, and that I love New Zealand, but that particular night at a Coliseum, I lost in one night $51,000.
Wow. We're going to hold you right there. We're going to come back on the Peet and Reed Show with more of the amazing Kreskin.
And his amazing stories.
Oh. Incredible.
Well, we're just sitting here entertaining the amazing Kreskin.
We don't even have to talk.
No, we're just...
I could just listen to him for hours.
Well, you know what? It's like every time his show was on, right? You always wanted it to be longer. And it never was.
I did. I totally did.
I want to interrupt for one moment because you hinted at this before. And folks listening in, listen to me, folks, because I've worked most of the talk shows in these various decades. It's refreshing to have a show on the radio or television where this is happening spontaneously. You don't walk back and correct your mistakes. If I told you how many, quote, live shows you now see on network television in the States that are live happening there, where the openings were done over again, Carson wouldn't think of this. You run with it, and that's what gives it the spontaneity. And the tragedy of is now, with all the reality shows that are going on, if you think they're reality shows, I will sell you the Brooklyn Bridge. I can tell you, without mentioning the show, one story where there was that famous argument in a clothing store. I happen to know the people who worked on the show. They went through it 9 times to get it right. Well, when I can see the way you folks work, you just don't turn around because something is lost in that quality.
Absolutely.
There's nothing better than something live and real.
You know, Bob Barker from The Price is Right, he always wanted to run live. And then one time they called a contestant down, and she was in the bathroom, and they waited for her to come back out.
the thing with Carson is he relished the errors that were made because that's what made the show special. Years ago, there was a man before any of you were born or most of you watching by the name of Jack Parr, and he had one of the early Tonight shows. And there was one night where he had... It was a seltzer. I won't mention the brand, but it was a new commercial. He didn't know any better. He opened the bottles and he poured one in the other. And before you know, the thing was exploding and busting all over the place. He lost a sponsor. Do you know that people the next day and from then on watched the show because they knew anything could happen, even losing a sponsor on the air.
Yeah.
Now,
exactly.
Let me ask, what was it like working with Carson the very first time? I mean, were you nervous?
I can't say that I was nervous. He was a very protective man of me. Now I will tell you a story that you folks don't know, an inside story. He had a man on that was a famous in the movie industry, he says, and they went to a break. It was Friday. He says, Johnny, you're not going to be on Monday, are you? And Johnny says, well, you know I take Mondays off. Why are you asking such a stupid question? This is in front of the audience, but the viewers didn't see this. He says, oh, because I'm going to do a Kreskin. Now watch me. Fred DeCord over who called me on the phone and talked to me years about, through the years, said, you'd had to have seen Kreskin. Johnny, off the air, slowly turned his head and said, what did you say? He says, I'm going to do a Kreskin. Johnny was off that Monday. Johnny came to work that Monday. He told his crew, if you tell anybody working on the show, the audience, and the guests, I will fire you. And he hid on the set. Who would have ever thought this man would hide on the set? This guy came out. He said, I'm going to have you people call out large numbers and the millions from the audience will put them on a blackboard. They wrote them on a blackboard. And I was told to watch because this was after the show was over. He says, I have a man in the audience I gave a prediction to. Would you come forward? The guy comes forward. This is the total here. Open the prediction and show it. He opened the prediction. The total that was written there was wrong. That wasn't what upset Carson. Carson found out that the man in the audience had an adding machine in his lap. Half the audience saw him adding and so forth. Carson said to the man, the person who came on, you will never perform on this show as long as you live. That man was the legendary movie producer and actor Orson Welles.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Many times, Kreskin, it was one of the stupidest things I ever did in my life. Now you know there are some stories behind all these people.
You know what I loved? I loved growing up watching your show, but I also have like the background of you because my brother would be in the bedroom imitating you. Yeah. And he drove us crazy. He'd come out into the living room or the, you know, we're sitting at the kitchen table and he'd go, I got it, I got it. And he'd have your voice and your mannerisms down. And we go, no, you don't. That's stupid. Go back in the bedroom. And then finally one day he came out and we went, yeah, you do. And so every time you would do it on stage would make me laugh so hard because I remember growing up with you.
Well, you know something? I'm not going to say goodbye. By the way, I'd like to, if it's all right with you folks, mention the book one more time in real time. It's in real time. They can get it by just going in Barnes & Noble's or look at my webpage. But I want to say this to all you folks as well because I feel like I've come to know you now as a team because you're going to be together. And they have a wider audience than you ever had before. That I can predict pretty safely, even without me on it, even without my revealing some of the thoughts that he has in mind as they are. But you know, can I? How many? We give. What do you got? A couple minutes left. I want to say this to both of you. I say this in my performance as well. I'm not going to say goodbye to you folks. I've already started my own radio series, which is now going to be syndicated, and we'll let you know about it. But I'm going to say goodbye. Let's just say in the spirit of broadcasting, to be continued.
Ah, love you. Mwah. Thank you so much. The Amazing Kreskin on the Peet and Reet Show. Yeah. Stick around. Go to subscribe, and you can find the whole show. Thank you so much. Yeah. You're such a sweetheart. We could spend hours with him.
Yeah, you know, it's too short. We got to do this again. We've got to have him up here in Niagara Falls.
Yeah.
Instead of satellite.
Or if you're in Buffalo, definitely let us know and we'll come see you.
I will. And I want to meet the villain with those hands.
You'll meet him. Thank you so much. And thank you for watching the Peet and Reet Show. And really, help us out. Subscribe, share, and like. And you know what? When you do stuff like that, you help us get on great entertainers like the Amazing Kreskin. I had so many questions.
I know. I that's why I said I could go on forever and ever, but it was fabulous. And he's such a sweetheart.
Yeah.
And he has such a childlike quality about him that makes it just fun to talk to. He lights up a room.
And he hasn't changed.
He hasn't changed a bit.
I want to ask him about predictions, but we didn't get there. So the next time he's on, I promise we'll do that. Anyways, you guys have yourselves a great week. We look forward to seeing you next time on the Peet and Reet Show. God bless.
only person who knows the combination of this safe. I told him what I was going to attempt to do. He says, I've watched you week after week. This is like the third year. I trust you. Hear this. On the air, we talked. Nothing was prearranged. He's the only one who knew the combination. And he agreed to climb in the safe, for which I slammed the door. And he was the only person who knew the combination. Now, lest anybody thinks this is insane and I was irresponsible because I can't always succeed. I had a man there with machine gear drill, and it was decided if I fail at a certain point, he's going to drill holes to put air into the safe. So I try. Whenever I hit the safe, he was to start thinking of the numbers. Every time I turn, it never worked. The door did not. I finally said, I don't know what to do. You're going to have to drill because I can't get the combination. We heard motions inside. We heard machinery. And here, because he was a safe man, a technician, was able to disimpart the inside of the safe and play around with the combination, and he got the door open. And he said, I said, oh my God, we were about to drill. Let me tell you what happened. When the show went off the air, I said to the man with the drill, you know, I was about to ask you, you had to drill the holes. And he said, Kreskin, please sit down. I said, what do you mean? He said, had you asked me at that point, it was too late. The drill would have taken too long and he would have never had the air to live.
Wow. I'm going to hold you right there. We're going to come back on the Peet and Reet Show.
Tell you a follow-up on that. Follow-up on that.
Yeah. Follow-up, yes, with more of the Amazing Kreskin and lots more stories.
And welcome back. You know, here we are listening to the Amazing Kreskin.
Who is it
all about? Not many people know about. The second year of my series, and it was on weekly, it was a half-hour show. A couple of things I did at the end of the half hour failed. They just didn't work out. That's the way we went off the air because it was never a rehearsal. Never a rehearsal. So in the second year or so, I was asked to meet with the head of the network. And that was in Ottawa at that time. The show moved to Toronto a year later, but I went to meet him. I walk in his office. And it wasn't that there were predators in the office. It wasn't that there were ominousness. It was worse than that. There were six attorneys. And I'm not knocking attorneys. I just wish that most of them had been on the Titanic. So anyway, so I walk in and we're talking. He says, Kreskin, he said, you don't rehearse the show. We trust what you do and so forth. Last week you did this special test and it didn't quite work. Would you consider doing a segment of your show over again if something fails? And now, for the first time, many of you have ever heard this, I didn't get temperamental. Oh my God, this was early in my career, but I said, sir, I just like to leave and give some thought. I walked down the office, walked down the hallway at Ottawa, at the network CTV, walked downstairs, called my manager in Pennsylvania and said, I don't know what to do. I know what to do. I don't repeat what I do. It's got to be done with integrity. And he said, just let them think about it. Well, the owner made a decision because the reason my shows are not edited is a failure is part of what I do and is the integrity and honesty of it. And he gave a ruling. My show was never, ever in the history of this series to be touched or tampered with. What he does, let it be the way it is. So there was one show I did, and the gentleman was a member of the Chubb Safe Company. On the air, against the wishes of the head of his company, he came on and said, Mr. Kreskin, I give you my word. I'm the only.
Hey, it's Peet and Reet, and welcome to our show. Today, kind of a special show for us.
Oh, for me, it's entirely special.
And you know, actually, anybody you ask, do you know this person?
And they do.
Yeah, so I think he's been in their heads And anybody that's ever watched, he's been in their heads.
Forever.
Of course, he's not a psychic, right? He's not a fortune teller.
No. He actually calls himself just an entertainer, but he's much more than that.
Absolutely much more than that. Why don't we tell him who's here?
The Amazing Kreskin.
Welcome.
Welcome.
How's it going? I have to tell, and I know this is a new series for you folks, but you've been together for, you said, as long as 10 years in radio, huh? Actually, folks, I'm not supposed to say this publicly, but they've been working together about 70-some years, but they look good, and they kept each other. I'm only kidding. But I got to tell all of you looking in, because you've followed me, obviously, through the years as a mentalist and my work dealing with the mind. I got to talk, I've spoken to Reed earlier, but to this gentleman, Pete on the right, I'm on the air, we're live with him, and I got to tell you folks looking in, God forbid I read his thoughts on the air.
See, I knew.
But you know, you're good people. We talked to your producer and what have you, and I want to quote me. I say this about all of them, on the two of them here and the production people. They're good folks. They're flaky, but they're good. And those are the only.
I like being flaky, though.
But those are the only interesting people.
You know what? You're flaky too, though.
That's exactly. Do you know my pictures? I'm sitting actually in my office, but my pictures of the people that are close to me through the years. Can you see my hands the way I hold them? They're on the wall, but they're on the wall like this.
A little.
And the first story he's telling us is
about a guy in a safe.
Yeah, who can't get out, and he's supposed to get him out and almost die. So continue the story.
Well, to wrap it up, Chris, I wish the man had let me know ahead of time that the air had been running out. I would have stopped. But you know, I'll tell you something. That gentleman agreed to come back 1 month later. Had a tremendous argument with the head of the company and said, no, I want to go on with this man. He said he would have a man with a drill there. I trust him this time around. And he came back on the air, another safe and a new combination. And he went in it. And within about 2.5 minutes, I turned the numbers that kept coming to me. And I successfully opened the safe. But you know, the best way I can describe what I do is my work is like an adventure. A man who reviewed me at a theater in Pennsylvania some years ago, and I was working there for a week. Opening night, he didn't review the show. And you can understand, folks, what happened. Next day, there's no review. Finally, the following morning, he came two nights in a row, and he came to the matinee, and he said, watching Kreskin each night on stage is like my reviewing a mystery story, but the solution is different every night. Because I can't say what the audience is going to think about. One man in Las Vegas, I mentioned two names at the Riviera. This elderly man real quick stood up and I said, who are these people? He said, Kreskin, we're not from here. We're from somewhere else in the country. These are our pets. We love them. I said, didn't you say to your wife, I wonder if Kreskin can tell me my army number. I wish we had a camera for television. He slammed his fist on the table and said, damn it, he said, I said that to her at dinner at another place, not even here, we were eating somewhere else. I said, who knows your army number? You folks ask your friends or uncles or what have you, or sisters. Nobody forgets it, but they don't tell anybody that. He says, I don't think I ever talked about my army number. I said, concentrate. I gave him every single digit in his army.
Cricket, a little cockeyed.
You know, in an era right now where we're going through something in the United States called being politically correct, I have a sign in my office here that if anyone ever calls me that I'm politically correct, they're to kick me in the ass.
I agree with you. I 100%. Hate that.
And remember, there's no age limit when you're in broadcasting either, right?
Yeah, that's true. You know, I've been in the airline industry. Well, I've been in this for a livelihood. I did a series on the CTV network years ago called The Amazing World of Kreskin.
From 1970 to 1980.
Now, YouTube has about 30 copies of the shows. For 2 years, it was the highest rated show for 2 years. Second only to hockey, but nothing beats hockey, obviously. Even the good Lord would have to take a detour if he walked through town and what have you, where there's a hockey game. But this is you know, Canada is like my second home. So much has happened to me through the years. I tour about 10 weeks a year in Canada, and the airline industry now estimates that I have flown in my career just a little over 3 million miles.
Wow. Well, you started out in Ottawa with that show, right?
What happened, the owner of the company sent a gentleman to follow me in the States in concerts, and I appear at universities, I appear at banquet halls, I appear in theaters. I didn't know that he was in the audience around the country maybe for 3, 4, 5 months, show after show after show. He went back to the owner and said, you know, I think there's a series here, because what I do for a living is basically involves my audience. There's no footlights between myself and the audience, because I'm reading the thoughts of my audience. It's not an illusion. It's not an act where there's theatrical stunts. I'm tuning in on what people are thinking. And that's why I think people keep coming back through the years. So an interesting thing happened that you folks in Canada don't know.